Swayam Prabha, Digital India, Educated India.
Hello dear students, I am Dr. Mona Simulti from HNB Garhwal University. I welcome you all in this module. And in continuation to the previous module, in that we have discussed about introduction to cosmetic preparations and different types of cosmetic preparation, little history about cosmetics. So all these things we discussed, and in this module, we will discuss about different types of excipients used in cosmetic preparations. So, we will discuss today in this module, we will discuss about surfactants and humectants used in cosmetic preparations. Okay? So, what is going to be the learning outcome of today's module? What are excipients, different excipients and different types of excipients, surfactants and their properties and humectants. So all these things we are going to learn today. And dear students, this is going to be our lesson plan. We'll move like, first we will see introduction to excipients. What are surfactants, properties, mechanism of surfactants and different types. And what are humectants, their properties and different types of humectants used in cosmetic preparations. So, dear students, excipients, what are excipients actually? Excipients are the ingredients other than active pharmaceutical ingredient, or we also call it as API, active pharmaceutical ingredients. So excipients are other than API in dosage form, and they have different functions depending on how they are used in the formulation or the type of formulations they are incorporated into. And pharmaceutical excipients and excipients. Okay, so the both terminologies are same. Okay, but API is little different. API has got the therapeutic effect, which is actually responsible for the purpose it is used for. Okay, if we take example of a dosage form, say, okay, so if we take example of a painkiller tablet, so paracetamol, that is the API in that. Okay, and other excipients which are used to give the bulk to the product. So this is the difference between active pharmaceutical ingredient and excipient. So similarly, in cosmetic preparations also, excipients have its own importance. So in certain cases, these excipients interact with the API in the final formulation, and they may affect the critical quality attributes of active ingredients like its stability, bioavailability. And once if the bioavailability is going to be affected, then it is affecting the final therapeutic effect of the formulation. So sometimes it may happen. Different excipients for cosmetics. So dear students, these are some cosmetics which are excipients which are used in cosmetic preparation: surfactant, rheology modifiers, humectants, emollients, preservative, antimicrobial used as a preservative, and antiperspirants and deodorants. So these are used with reference to cosmetic formulations. Now, properties of excipients. See, these are some general properties of excipients, like it should be non-toxic, non-irritant, cheap and readily available, compatible with the ingredient of the product. That means the pharmaceutical excipient must be compatible. There should not be any kind of interaction with the active pharmaceutical ingredient. So no interaction with the API, and stable and not affected by the temperature, light and hydrolysis. So these are some common properties of excipient. A good excipient should have these properties. Now directly we will move to surfactants. So surfactants, they lowers the surface tension between two liquids or between a liquid and a solid and increases the solubility. So it means that surfactant, when we use surfactant in any formulation, it is going to help in solubilizing the things. Okay, so when it increases the solubility, then it increases the absorption, and once the absorption is increased, it increases the bioavailability also. So this is the role of surfactant, and based on requirements, different category of surfactants are used. And dear students, surfactants must contain a lipophilic region and a hydrophilic region. So we can say that surfactants are amphiphilic in nature. So amphiphilic means affinity, double affinity. Okay, so hydrophilic as well as hydrophobic, both they are. So dear students, look at the surfactant molecule. So as you can see in this picture, this is the hydrophilic head, like water. Okay, it hates oil, and this is the lipophilic tail. Okay, so this is surfactant molecule. So now the market for cosmetic surfactant, it has grown extensively during past few years, and surfactants are very important, especially when we talk about cosmetic preparations, because mostly cosmetic preparations are used for cleansing purpose, and there a surfactant plays a very important role. And if I take example of cosmetic as well as toiletry preparations, so in both the formulations, surfactant is very important. So this could be attributed to the increased use of cosmetic associated with the improved living standard and cultural shift worldwide. Okay, so they are derived from substances naturally present in the body, and they are safe also. Mechanism of action of surfactant. So dear students, how it works, like surfactant molecule, how it works, when it is placed in aqueous solvent, the surfactant at a concentration known as critical micellar concentration orient themselves in such a way that their polar head face the polar face. Okay, so this orientation helps in increasing the contact angle between the aqueous phase and non-polar portion of the surfactant. So this phenomena is known as micellization, and the aggregate thus forms are termed as micelles. So the concentration of surfactant decides the shape of these aggregates, which varies from lamellar to cylindrical shape. So this is mechanism of action of surfactants. When we select surfactant or when we select a surfactant to use, it is just equally important as that we are looking to achieve the finished product. So each surfactant has a key function, key role to play in which it excels. And also surfactant molecules have some limitations also. So surfactant use in body care preparation, especially when we are talking about cosmetic preparation, they can even be termed as a detergent or soap. And when foam is the final product, the surfactant may be referred as a foaming agent, and they are sometimes termed as lubricant. When we take example of shaving cream, as they protect the skin from irritation and the laser sharp edge while still allowing the removal of the unwanted hairs. So this is one example. So surfactant plays different role as a foaming agent, as a detergent, and as well as lubricant. So dear student, let's summarize the things what we learned in this module. So till now in this module we discussed about what are excipients. So excipients are the ingredients other than API, and API which is responsible for the therapeutic effect. So other ingredients apart from the API which are used in the cosmetic formulations are excipients, and with reference to cosmetics we are talking about excipients here. So here we started from surfactants. So surfactants are the molecules, they lower the surface tension, thereby they increase the solubility. And surfactant has a very important role because mostly preparations are used for cleansing purposes. Okay, so and we also discussed here the mechanism of action of surfactant and how the surfactant molecules looks like. Now in this slide we will see different types of surfactant. So as you can see in the figure, hydrophilic head and hydrophobic tail, this I also discussed earlier. So this is the molecule of a surfactant, and now we will see different types of it. Anionic, first class of surfactant. So this surfactant possesses a negative charge on their hydrophilic head. The negative charge helps the surfactant molecules lift and suspend soil in micelles. So one of the drawback of using anionic surfactant relates to the skin sensitivity. So due to high foaming, cleansing and washing capability, skin irritation can also occur. So this is the drawback of anionic surfactant. Okay, anionic surfactant, soap and other carboxylates, sulfates, if we take example sodium lauryl sulfate and sodium lauryl sulfate, sulfonates, alkyl benzene sulfonates. So these are few examples of anionic surfactants, the most popular anionic surfactant. SLS, so as we all know, as and when the anionic surfactants terminology comes in our mind, directly we think of SLS. Okay, so dear student, remember SLS is, and it produces high foam and it's easy to thicken, ammonium lauryl sulfate and sodium stearate. So these are some popular anionic surfactants. So dear student, if it is asked in the examination, write about anionic surfactant, maybe 2 marks or as the question paper says. So please do write these 3 examples. Okay, so these are very important types of surfactants we are talking about. Now amphoteric surfactant, so these carry both the charges, positive and negative charges, so thereby they exhibit dissociations both anionic and cationic in nature. So this characteristics is termed as Zwitter ionic. Amphoteric surfactants are primarily used in cosmetics as a secondary surfactant. So they boost the foam, improve conditioning and reduce irritation. Okay, so coca bentine, lauryl bentine and hydroxysultanes. Okay, so these are few example of amphoteric surfactant. And when amphoteric surfactant is used in the formulation where the finished product has low pH, the amphoteric surfactant takes on one more conditioning and nourishing role. So on the other hand, when the amphoteric surfactant is used in the formulation where there is a high pH is the end product. So it resembles more of an anionic surfactant with the high foaming and cleansing capability. Okay, so neither option is necessarily bad. They are just on two different planes of the beneficial skin aspect. So what does it mean? It means that amphoteric surfactants are important. The thing is conditionally how they are going to be used in the formulation. So some examples of well-known amphoteric surfactants are as we discussed. So these are coca bentine, laurel bentine. So these are few examples. Cationic surfactants. So moving to the another class of surfactants. Till now anionic surfactant we have discussed and amphoteric surfactants. Cationic surfactants, the hydrophilic region is positively charged. Okay, so these surfactants dissociate in water to produce an amphiphilic cation and an anion. So these surfactants have good antibacterial activity and they are used in cleaning of burns and wounds. Cationic surfactants example, if we take cetrimide, cetrimonium chloride, sterile cholium chloride. So these are few examples. So dear students, please remember these examples. So now these surfactants are best used in preparation where foaming is not necessarily mandatory as such as in hair conditioner. Okay, you might have seen when we apply the conditioner we don't the conditioner do not produce foam. So cationic surfactants are used especially in hair conditioner product where surfactant alone do not allow for ample foaming capability. So both amphoteric and non-ionic surfactant will be compatible with the cationic surfactant. So dear students, let's again summarize here. Till now what we studied? We studied what are excipients, their properties, surfactants, what are surfactants, and what are different types of surfactants which are used in cosmetic preparations. And we started from discussing different classes of surfactant. Anionic we discussed, amphoteric, cationic surfactants. So till now in this module we discussed, and the remaining class of surfactant, that is non-ionic surfactant. This we will see in the next slide. So dear students, non-ionic surfactant, these carry no charge and therefore do not ionize in the presence of water. So they have excellent emulsifying and oil removing property besides being resistant to deactivation by ions like calcium, magnesium and imparting hardness to water. Non-ionic surfactants, the primarily non-ionic surfactant used in the cosmetics are alcohol, acetyl and sterile alcohol, amine oxide, polysorbate esters. So these are the examples. Non-ionic surfactants have no foaming capability, which is why this group of surfactants are rarely used in the formulation. Non-ionic surfactant can also be sometimes used in the formulation to reduce irritants due to their gentle cleansing ability. So dear students, moving to the next excipient, humectant. So humectant, very important. It attracts and retains the moisture in the air nearby via absorption. drawing the water vapor into or beneath the organism's or object's surface. So best humectants, best use of humectant is in the cosmetics. How? We will see. To prevent drying of the product after application to the skin, we are talking with respect to cosmetics. So humectant, to prevent drying of the product from the container after its first opening, to prevent cap locking caused by condensation onto the neck of container closure or container after its opening. Okay, so humectant plays a very vital role. So the ideal properties of humectant: high moisture absorption over a wide range of humidity, consistent moisture content even in changing humidity, non-toxic and safe to use for cosmetics, low odor, low color and low viscosity to make the compounding easier, generally non-reactive with other cosmetic ingredient, and the cost is low and it is readily available. So these are few ideal properties of humectant. Okay, humectant. Structure of humectant. So they all have multiple hydroxyl groups. So dear student, always remember that humectant preparations, humectant when used in the preparation, they prevents drying out of a product, final product. They are going to prevent the drying out during the formulation preparation and after the opening of container. So a structure of humectant, they all have multiple hydroxyl group or other hydrophilic sites that can interact through hydrogen bonding with water molecule. For the most part, humectants are nonpolar molecules compatible with the water. So the manner humectants work is that they attract water from either the atmosphere or from the body, and it bind itself via a chemical element bonding. So structure we are discussing. So this property is known as hygroscopicity, and it can be measured for any kind of humectant, hygroscopicity. So this is one parameter for humectant to measure its efficiency. The amount of water that a material can bind at the specific humidity is called the equilibrium hygroscopicity. Okay, so in general, the more moisture a humectant will absorb, the better it is for formulation. So what is the main role of humectant? Is to absorb moisture and prevents drying out of formulation. Okay dear students, so please remember, this is very important. So different types of humectant: inorganic humectant and organic humectant. So there are limited use of cosmetics due to their corrosive nature and compatibility problem. So inorganic humectants, they have the corrosive nature and they are not much compatible with the other ingredients, and organic humectants, they are very widely used and cosmetics because of their good compatibility with the other excipients. So glycerol and mannitol, you might have heard of that. Whenever we think of humectant, the glycerol only comes in our mind, that glycerol is a good humectant. It is an organic humectant, and mannitol. So example of inorganic humectant is calcium chloride. This is third category, metal organic humectant. So these also suffers from the compatibility problem along with the corrosive nature, hence they are not much used in the cosmetic preparations. If you take example, sodium lactate is the example of metal organic humectant. So dear students, different types of humectants we are discussing here, and when we talk about exam point of view, if multiple choice question is asked, these examples are very important with the property. They may be asked that say for example, which one of the below is example of metal organic humectant. So you will be given four options. So you have to choose the correct option. Similarly for organic and inorganic. So if MCQ comes in the examination, so for that point you have to remember the example and their properties. Okay. And even in this module, earlier we discussed about anionic, cationic, non-ionic and amphoteric surfactants also we discussed. So there also, dear students, please remember examples of each category. So this is very important. And it may also be asked individually, like write short note on anionic surfactant depending on the marks weightage in the question paper. Okay. So these are few examples of the questions which may comes in the examination. So other examples of humectants apart from glycerol, mannitol and so propylene glycol and aloe vera gel, alpha hydroxy acid such as lactic acid, egg yolk and egg white, and glyceryl triacetate, honey, lithium chlorides. These are some other examples of humectants. So dear students, please do remember. Now humectants in skincare product. So humectants are added to skincare product as it enhances transepidermal water loss by increasing water absorption from the dermis into the epidermis. Dermis and epidermis, these are layers of skin. So as you know, so what they do, they enhances the transepidermal water loss. And many humectants also have emollient property, although all the humectants are not emollient. So good moisturizer have combination of these two things, emollients and humectants. And when we classify moisturizers, so we can classify emollients, humectants in the category of moisturizer. So you got the point? So in order to hydrate the stratum corneum, okay, so good moisture capture capacity they have. So look at the special use of humectants. Used as an excipient in injectable formulation, used as a laxative when taken in large quantity, used for synthesis via a variety of other non-toxic and biologically safe surfactants. So as a additive in the food for keeping the moist and tasty, these are also used. The other benefit for the use of humectant to assist in low temperature and freeze the stability, where they act as a antifreeze, and in case of clear the clear appearance of shampoo, they assist in maintaining the clarity of the shampoo at lower temperatures. So these are few references. So dear students, please go through. So let us summarize. In this module we discussed about excipients used in cosmetic preparation. Okay, we started from discussing, remember, surfactants, okay, and humectants. Two major excipients we discussed here in this module: surfactants, classes of surfactants, anionic, non-ionic surfactants, cationic surfactants and amphoteric surfactant, and their examples, properties. Okay, and we also discussed its mechanism of action. And humectants we discussed, what are ideal properties of humectant and classes of humectant and the special types of humectant and their role in cosmetic formulations. So dear students, please go through from this module, and with exam point of view, I told you earlier also in this module that please do remember the example. Here we have given the general concept of excipient, and when we will move in the next, when we will discuss in the next modules, when we will discuss different formulations of cosmetics, there we will discuss the importance of the concentration they are used. So dear students, please do remember the standard range of concentration of these humectants. Okay, so when you will write examples, please do write the standard concentration they are used in cosmetic preparations. All right, so the small questions may come from this topic like MCQs or a short note question that you can say, for example, write short note on surfactants. So you have to, what you have to do there, you have to start writing the what are surfactants and classification of surfactants, different classes you will mention, different examples you will mention, and don't write the mechanism of action if it is of 2.5 marks or 2 marks. Okay, and detailed question comes, then you can write the, you can describe it from beginning to the end. Okay, similarly with the humectants. So dear students, in this module we have learned about surfactant and humectant. So stay tuned for more videos, and thank you so much for watching this video.